Good morning. I'm Sofia and I'm coming from the University of Edinburgh to talk about whether the possibilities of detecting cognitive decline through dialogue processing. So you would expect maybe that people with different conditions in mental health would have different ways to speak. And this is something that linguists, mental health experts, and more recently computational linguists and informaticians, computer scientists, etc., have been working on. Some examples of this work say that for different.
I think you're not hearing me properly. No? Are you?
Sorry. Different conditions, you get certain accuracy when you want to. When you analyze when you analyze speech tasks and you try to predict the severity of a condition or the appearance in the case of schizophrenia. It's also been done for depression and anxiety through a map, for example, and they can predict recovery and dropout. But in the case that's the most relevant for me, for the trait I'm doing, which is dementia, there's been a lot of work, but the most recent model is Fraser et al. And they use mainly narrative tasks and acoustic features as well to predict the diagnostic label, basically. And they reach quite a high accuracy. However, the tasks that are usually recorded in these cases are narrative task, as I was saying, which means that basically the person speaks, maybe describing a picture or a series of pictures, or relating a procedural task, like how do you make coffee or something like this, but never in an actual interactive conversation, usually not in an actual conversation, which is where we would usually use language. So this is what our project is about. We want to use these interactive features, we want to include them in this sort of models and see whether this improves the accuracy that has been reached so far. So there's a couple of studies that use dialogue, but they're not they don't do it in a computational or automatic way, or using natural language processing. But they do give us some confidence, not that there is features that we can address or we can include in the models. Like, people may avoid answering questions because they don't know the answer, or they just I'm not sure if they're the relevant person to answer this, or the turn-taking behavior is also can be also disrupted, which is one of the things we use. Or the back-channeling, which is basically failing to give feedback of your understanding or the mutual understanding to the person you are speaking to. Laughter is a bit controversial because it could be genuine, but it could be also covering up embarrassment or something like that. We analyzed a small subset of data, of the data set that we have, using only basic prosodic information like speech rate and the turn-taking patterns. So far we have only tried with a very simple classifier as a sort of like. It doesn't have a lot of insight, it just say whether we can predict it or not with the information that the data set has. But it does give an idea, an exciting result, that dialogue can actually help in this model because we do get a high accuracy. Even though it's a very small subset of data, it's like 17 people with AD and Alzheimer's disease and 21 without. But still, also, we get the probabilities of the turn-taking behavior, the speech rate in syllables per minute, although we want to change this for the next analysis, and we basically just predict, no? We now want to extend this to the rest of the data set. We want to apply other techniques, other algorithms, and see, like, how can we fit this in interactive features in models like Fraser, you know, that they do get a very high accuracy. Then one of the main reasons why we think in dialogue is a good approach is that when you're using intern behavior or turn taking patterns or speech related basic prosodic information to analyze the cognitive status of the person in this case, you are not depending on content as much as you would be depending on content in the narrative tasks, or as much as you would be depending on content even if you record the conversation with your GP, for instance, with your doctor, but you analyze the content. So it's not our case, we don't want to analyze the content, or at least not primarily, because we think first it may be biased, like if you are in a control group or you are in the group with dementia, your conversation with your doctor is going to be different. And also, looking out for public health, like, there's about 200 countries and only 18 speak English like, as native language. So we would like to build a model, no? Or to help building a model that reaches or is not restricted to English in this way. So yeah, I know I didn't speak a lot of the methodology, but my poster is downstairs, and if you have an interest, you're really welcome to.